So why I'm giving this talk? Basically, I really like to read about distributed systems, and that's why I came across to gossip protocols. And when I started reading about gossip protocols, I tried to find something easy to digest, something to read in, 2 hours and understanding, and it was really difficult for me to find something like that. So I ended up reading a lot of papers about distributed systems. After that, I created an article explaining how they work, and I gave a talk in Papers We Love in Spain about them, and it was so boring that I literally could see people falling asleep. So I decided to change a little bit the talk and do it a little bit more practical, and that's why I created the simulator that you saw before. So my goal with this talk basically is to try to explain in a way that you can see how they work, who type of applications are using these protocols, the different application and use cases that you have for gossip protocols, problems that they solve. So I'm going to try through, first of all, through the problems, and then with explaining how they work. So the first problem, let's imagine that we have a set of nodes, and basically we want one of the nodes to start sending a message to all of the other nodes in the cluster. It seems easy, right? We just need to have a list of all the nodes in the system, and that's it. That implies that as we want to all the nodes to be able to send a message to all other nodes in the system, that implies that every node has a list of all the nodes in the system. So what happens if one of the nodes is down? We need to update all the nodes in the cluster. They need to update the list, right? But what if the node is not down? It's just slow. Or there is a network partition. They can end up in a situation in which every node has a different view of the system. And it's not only that, it's that they're also really difficult to scale. Imagine that you have 10,000 nodes, and you want to send a message to all of them, and you start iterating. The difference in time between the first message and the last message is going to be huge. There are also more problems. Imagine that we want to send a heartbeat. A heartbeat is something like saying every node to every other node is going to say, hey, I'm alive. So that means that you're sending n square messages, and as this is a heartbeat normally is 1 second, something like that. That means that we're sending n square messages every second. So for example, with 1,000 nodes, we're sending 1,000,000 messages every second. So it's not going to scale. Wouldn't it be better if we could send a message to a subset of the nodes, then those subset of nodes to another subset of nodes, and so on and so forth, until we reach all the nodes in the system? That's one of the things that we can do with gossip protocols. And we might be tempted, continuing with the previous problem, to have a centralized server with the list of the nodes. Because in that case, now nodes, they don't need to take care of the list, right? But we are in an even worse situation than before. We still have the problem of scalability. And now, if we suffer a network partition or that server is down, none of the nodes can do any work, OK? So the ideal situation is one in which every node is autonomous and can make decisions on its own. And that's one of the things also that we can do with OSI protocols, so how they're designed to do that, basically. In a perfect world, also, every node will share only the information that they have, only with nodes that they don't have that information. But that's really, really tricky. But that means that each node knows exactly the information that every other node has. It's impossible to do it. So for example, let's imagine that we have 4 nodes, and each of these nodes have a secret. And we want to end up in a situation in which every node has the same state. So how many messages do you think that we need in order for all the nodes to have the same information and we don't send the same information twice to one of the nodes? It's been proven that it's 2n-4, that is not a lot, it could be okay, but the problem with this is that we need to know the perfect sequence or path in order to do that. This is one of these sequences. So for example, A exchanges information with B, C with D, A with D, and B with C, and now all the nodes have the same information. But let's do one small thing. Let's change the order of this and see what happens. Now, A exchanges information with B, B with C, C with D, and A with D. And now, B doesn't have all the information in the cluster. And we just changed the order of the path. Imagine in a real system in which basically nodes are living and joining whenever they want, imagine the level of synchrony that you need in order to achieve that. It's going to be impossible. So wouldn't it be better if basically every node could have like an optimal path, like building a path for sending the message? That's one of the things that we can do with gossip protocols. We can build overlay networks. So for example, one example of that is Plan 3. Basically, within gossip, they keep a broadcast tree to send messages. One of the problems, so far I've been talking a lot about nodes that are down, but there are other problems, is that what happens when a node is joining the system? We need a way to tell the other node, now I'm alive, there is a new node in the system. Or imagine in the situation in which there is a new leader in a cluster, we need a way to set to all other nodes in the system, hey, this is the new leader. Gossip protocol can be used for that too. And this is actually really, really important. I've been talking a lot about nodes that are down, and that they're slow, or they're suffering network partitions. But how can you tell? How can you tell when a node is down? This is a tricky problem, especially for the distributed systems, and it's something that, for example, we need in order to solve to have consensus algorithms. This is called failure detectors, and gossip protocols normally are used to detect them, basically. But what are they? They are just a broadcast protocol. We want to send a message to all the nodes in the system. The main motivation is to trade the strong reliability guarantees offered by coarsely deterministic methods for weaker, stronger reliability guarantees, but in return, obtain really good scalability properties. It's not really clear, or at least I didn't find it, that when it was the first time the gossip protocol were used, but it's believed that it was in 1987, in this paper, in Epidemic Algorithms for Replicate Database Maintenance. This paper is, in my opinion, really fun. It's really worth reading it. They were basically building a distributed K-value store in 1987, and it's really fun to see, for example, the network that they had, the computers that they were using. It's also really important because basically it lies the foundations of gossip protocols. There are a lot of concepts that we're using today that came from that, in gossip that came from that paper, like anti-entropy, rumor-mongering, fan-out. I'm going to talk about them later. And for me, one of the most important things, or it was really useful for me, is that the first analysis of reliability, and it's easy to understand how they did it and how it works. The paper is inspired by epidemics and human gossip, but most of the papers that you're going to find are inspired by the same thing, and also with social networks. And it makes sense, in my opinion, because just in real life, the key property of gossiping is the fact that it can spread quickly and be extremely persistent, even in situations in which groups change with respect to their membership and the relationship between the group members. Okay? Also, rumors in society travel at a great speed and reach almost every member of the community, and what is really, really most important, without needing a central coordinator. And if you think about that, that's key for scalability and for being fault tolerance. Also, in epidemics theory, it's been proven that starting with a single subject, or not in our case, infected subject, the time to infect the entire population is proportional to the log of the population size. So, in other words, the infected population grows exponentially, but the time to infect that population grows logarithmically. Okay? That's, by the way, a simulation of a zombie holocaust. And you can see how quickly, basically, spread. But how do they work? Let's see. Let's go to the simulator and see how it works. The idea behind them is really, really simple. So basically, we have a node that wants to share the information with the whole cluster. So in order to do that, what it's going to do, it's periodically is going to be selecting n random nodes. How many? That's the fan out, one of the parameters of the algorithm. Okay, so select the nodes and then send the message to them. Now, in the next cycle, those nodes are going to do exactly the same thing. Okay, and they're going to do the same. So let's see it in action. This one, for example, play and see it. Okay, perfect. It's really easy, really simple, right? The most important thing to keep in mind for now with this simulation is that they can be modeled deterministically. You can see here a really, really simplistic equation that allows you to predict more or less how many rounds is going to take a message to reach all the nodes in the system. And in general, we can say that it's O log n runs for a message to reach all the nodes in the cluster. It's simplistic because we're not taking into account failure nodes, message loss, and things like that. But even with that, it's pretty good. We're going to go back to the simulator several times. So let's go back to the slides. There have been many attempts to define what they are, But there is no standard definition for gossip protocols, but you can normally you're going to find these properties. No selection must be random, or at least guarantee enough peer diversity, and this is really, really, really important. Imagine that you have your random is not fair, and you're always selecting the same node. All the properties that these algorithms had, they go away. Only local information is available to all nodes, so basically nodes are not aware of the global state of the system, and they act only with local knowledge. Transmission and communication is RAM-based, like what we've seen before in the simulator. And one thing that for me is really important too is that transmission and processing capacity per round is limited. Because basically this is a communication protocol. You're normally going to be using that in databases or bigger applications. So you don't want your communication protocol to take up all the resources of your machines, like CPU or RAM or whatever. And the last thing is that normally all nodes run the same protocol. So basically you're not going to be dealing with different versions of the protocol. Okay? And here is the key of understanding these protocols. And this is the key property, and is that they are randomized algorithms. Because basically, they're selecting the node to exchange information with randomly. Okay, so this has profound implications on the analysis of these protocols. First of all, they're not deterministic, because it's not possible to mimic the behavior. If you run the same algorithm twice in the same node, the outcome is going to be different, because it's going to be selecting different nodes. So it's really difficult to debug, for example. But the expected, if we look at the whole execution of the protocol, we expect to all nodes to have the same information. So we can say that we can see them as deterministic, okay, methods. But the important thing to remember is that they only provide probabilistic guarantees. First of all, because they choose the node randomly. So as I said before, if for whatever reason the random selection is not fair, we're not going to be able to reach all the nodes in the system. If we always choose that node, there is no way that I'm going to send a message to that node. Okay? So there is only probabilistic guarantees there. And other thing that is really important is that they don't provide any mechanism to guarantee that each node receives each message. So you never know if it's true that all the nodes they receive the message. Okay? But normally, the achieved success probabilities for them are close to one. Okay, so I'm going to explain a little bit more about the probability of these protocols. First of all, the probability is related to the system side, the host failures, the message loads, the number of gossip targets, the time that we're spreading a message. So, for example, in this case, what we can see is it's the fanout required to achieve success probability greater than 99.9. as a function of the failed node. So for example, in the blue line, we can see that for 100,000 nodes, even though 50% of them are failing, we still are able to achieve success probability greater than 19.9 just by increasing the fanout to 40. Now, does this mean that we need to increase the fanout in order to have those probabilities? No. What this means is that they choose to use the fanout. It could be another parameter. For example, the time that we're spreading an information. Let's put an example. Let's imagine that we have in the simulator, I can show you, it's going to be easier. If I found the, there I am, okay. So for example, let's imagine that this node has a whole view of the system and we choose to have only a fanout or two, okay? And we start deleting nodes. Still, we're going to achieve the success probability close to greater than 99.9. What is going to happen is it's going to take longer. But the trade-off that we're making here is that we're going to be to keep sending the message all the time at infinitum. So at some point, it will reach because basically it has links with all the nodes in the system. Okay, so depending on your configuration and depending on the application, there are different trade-offs. From my experience reading about them, I think that it's impossible to beat in order to explain them, the simulator that the people for HashiCorp created. So HashiCorp, I guess that most of you know what HashiCorp is, they have a tool that is called Consul. In Consul, they're using Serve. Serve is an implementation of SWIM. SWIM is a gossip protocol, and Serve the implementation, as I said. And this is the simulator of convergence. And it's really, really good to understand the trade-offs with this algorithm. So basically, what this means is here we have our system is consistent, and 99.9, basically, all the nodes have the same information. And this is the time to achieve that. And one of the things that we can say is, OK, I want my system to be faster. OK, let's put us fan out of 6. Now it's going to take only 1 second. But did you look at the estimated bandwidth? I'm going to go back to 3. We could easily double the bandwidth. So it's a trade-off. We can see also that right now it's taking almost 2 seconds. Let's start simulating that 60% of the nodes are failing. And we want to see that we can see that it's still the same convergence, but now it's 4 seconds. Let's do it even more, 90. And now it's 16 seconds, more or less. And we still have the same probability that the whole system is going to converge. Okay, so it's a matter of trade-offs. Probably in order to achieve that, what is happening is that they're spreading the information. They continue to share the information all the time. Okay. Let's go back. Okay, so depending on how they exchange information between the nodes, there are different strategies. We can see basically 3 of them. Push is when a node that has some information sends that information in the next cycle to other node. Pull is when every node is asking other nodes, do you have anything for me? And then that node sends it back. Push and pull is a mix between between them. When you have, so if you push the N key, that happens. Good to know. And push and pull basically is that, I'm going to put it again. With push and pull, what happens is that you send information to that node, and that node also sends you information back. Okay? There are advantages and disadvantages with all these strategies. When there are a lot of updates, pull is really good, because it's pretty likely that when you are connecting to a node, that node is going to have something for you. When there are very few updates in the system, pull is not efficient, because you're going to be doing a lot of requests to nodes that they don't have nothing for you. So those connections or those messages are going to be in vain. And push is really good when there are very few updates, because it's efficient, because push means that I'm only going to be sending information if I have something to say. Okay? Most of the papers that I read, or most of them, use push and pull. There are also papers that they take advantage of these advantages and disadvantages. And they use a strategy that is called first push and then pull. So, but as I said, most of them, in my opinion, are push and pull. OK, so now that we know more or less how it works, the type of messages, the strategies that we have, what are the applications that they have? What are the use cases that we can use GOSIP for? There are more than that, but in my opinion, these are the more important. First of all, for database application, for example, Cassandra uses a type of GOSIP that is called anti-entropy. Basically, what they do is, what anti-entropy means is that from time to time, one node selects randomly another node, and they say they have any differences, and if they have, they reconcile the data. Cassandra uses Merkle trees for that, but there are different ways to do it. There are also databases that they use GOSIP for replicate data between the nodes. The other day, someone mentioned to me that GOSIP is being used also for consistent hashing. When you are in consistent hashing, you have to rebalance the data. And they're using GOSIP for that. There's also use for information dissemination. So for example, sending some information to all the nodes in the cluster, like leader election. For cluster membership, so that every node can have a view of all the nodes in the system. This is really, really tricky when you are reading papers, and I'm going to explain this better later. Because basically, all the applications that you can see there rely on a cluster membership, okay? Also for failure detectors, so basically know which nodes are really live in the system. For building overlay networks, like what I mentioned before, so for example, you can build an overlay network based on geographical proximity, and you can use GOSIP for that. For aggregations, like calculate average, sum and maximums, or aggregation of queries, this is normally used in peer-to-peer systems. I know for sure that this has been used for detecting DDoS attacks. There are a lot of papers about that, so if someone is interested. And this is a few of the samples that you can find GOSIP. There are a lot of tools out there and systems that they're using GOSIP. This is only a few of them. So for example, React uses a GOSIP protocol to share, communicate, and communicate the running state. In Cassandra, as I said before, for anti-entropy, they also use GOSIP in order to exchange information between the nodes in the system so that all the nodes have the same information about the state of the system. Dynamo uses a GOSIP protocol for cluster membership and for failure detectors. Consul I mentioned before that they're using SERP for two things, discovering new nodes, so cluster membership, and sending a broadcast like lead election, so information dissemination. Amazon S3 uses gossip in order to share the state of the nodes in the cluster. We found out about this because they had an outage in 2008, and in the postmortem they mentioned that it was related to gossip. I'm going to explain it later because it's, in my opinion, a fun fact of the problems with gossip protocols. And yeah, last thing that everyone is seems that they like to talk about blockchain. This is also using blockchain. The miners basically exchange information about, I think it's the value of the nouns, and they use gossip in order to exchange that information. So why all these tools are using gossip? Mostly because they have all these strengths, and they're really good in these things. First of all, they're scalable, and they're scalable because in general it takes all log n rounds for a message to reach all the nodes in the system, and even in the face of host failure and message loss. Also, each node sends only a fixed number of messages, independently of the number of nodes in the system. So let's imagine that we have a cluster with 1,000 nodes, and half an out of three. Each node is going to send three messages. Now, for whatever reason, our cluster goes to 2 million nodes. Each node is still going to be sending only three messages, okay? Because that's the fan out. They also normally fire and forget, which means that they don't wait for acknowledgments and they don't take any recovery action. A message doesn't arrive to destination. Just basically they keep going, and in the next round they're going to send information. This is not all of them. There are applications or implementations that they use TCP, but most of them are like that. They are also fault tolerant because they have the ability to operate in networks with irregular and non-connectivity, and they're really, really well in these situations. They work really, really well because basically a node shares the same information several times to different nodes. Okay, so if a node is not accessible through one route, it's going to send information to a different node and for a different route. So basically, there are a lot of routes by which information can flow from one node to another node. And they are robust because there is no node that plays a specific role in the system. So a failed node will not prevent other nodes from continuing sending information to the system. And also, each node can join and leave whenever they please without disrupting the quality of service of the system. Okay, so let's see these properties in the simulator. Here I am. Perfect. So I don't know if you remember, but in the first execution of this, it took three rounds to reach all the nodes in the system, right? Let's start with 60 and see what happened. Okay. Oh. 1 sec, because it was in the late state. So. Perfect. Now, let's see what happens. Okay, so four rounds. So basically, we have twice the nine of nodes, but the number of rounds to reach all the nodes in the system is only four, okay? So far, it seems like the way they grow is good. Let's see what happens if we keep increasing the nodes. Oh, that's a lot. It's not going to be able to keep with that. I was going to put 120, so probably it's better if I... Bear with me, JavaScript is not my thing, so this is not optimized at all for JavaScript. So there is a reason why it's going to be slower and slower, and is that I'm painting everything. Even if you don't see something, it's still be painted. So that's why. Okay, so let's see what happens. Probably it's going to take more or less the same thing that before, or one round more. Perfect. So now we have twice the number of the nodes that we had before, but we still had the same number of rounds, four, okay? Let's keep going until 240. I think that's going to be too much for this implementation, but okay. Perfect. As you can see, it's slower and slower every time. But now it should be between four and five, something like that. The good thing about this is that you can see there are several things that you can see in the simulator. How the bandwidth is consumed for a lot of messages that are exactly the same thing that before, and how every node is receiving basically a lot of copies of the same information. Okay, so now five, I don't remember, it was 5, the previous one, or it was 4? 4. So now it's 5. So if you think about it, we started with 30 nodes. So basically, we have 8 times more nodes than before, and it's only 2 more rounds to reach all the nodes in the cluster. So you can see how they're really, really well at the scalability. Let's start to see why they're 4 tolerant. I'm going to go back to 30. That's going to be easy. So in the simulator, one of the things that I do, you'll see this simulate real links between nodes, okay? Which means that if I cut one of these links, the nodes are still alive, but they can see each other, okay? Well, actually, this node, if I cut this line between this, this node can see this, but this node still can see that, okay? Because the simulator is not perfect, basically. But the idea of the simulation is that they simulate how sometimes nodes can see each other even though that they are alive, okay? So I'm going to try to do that. Perfect, and then I'm going to start deleting links. I guess at some point I will do something that I don't have to do this one by one, but for now, this is what I have. So bear with me for a while. It's really difficult to do it. Looking at that with my neck completely. Okay, I think it's enough and it's for the talk, because otherwise my neck is going to hurt a lot at some point. Okay, so let's unselect the nodes. So because basically we want only one to be sending information to, as we've done before. Okay, so there are several nodes in the system that they don't see each other. So let's see what happens. It should be basically the same thing because I haven't cut a lot of links, okay? So it's 3. But if I keep cutting and cutting, they're going to be, all the nodes are going to receive the same information. What is going to happen is that it's going to take longer. Because basically in each round, what is going to happen is that they're going to be seeing less nodes, so they have to start changing to another node, okay? And the last one, that the properties that I mentioned is that they are robust. And what I mentioned is that they're robust because there is no node that plays a specific role in the system. Let's see what I mean by that. Now, let's start basically cutting nodes. So these nodes are actually dead. Not bad, eh? I don't like JavaScript, so not bad. Okay. Let's see what happens. So we can see that at some point they will reach that node and they're able to share the information. The takeaway from this that we're going to see later in the problems that we can find with them is that if you look at the view that each of my nodes has, it's a complete view. So basically, as every node is seen all over other node, it doesn't matter if some of them are down because they're still going to see the other ones, okay? Where am I? Okay. So going back to the slides, they're not robust in all the circumstances. I mentioned before that there was an outage in Amazon S3 in 2008, and it was related to gossip. What happened, it's funny because what happened is that the gossip protocol worked really, really well. The problem is that the message that they were spreading, it was corrupted. There was a bit that was corrupted. So basically the whole nodes in the cluster end up with bad information. So they had to shut down the system in order to fix the problem. So I like to see this because you can see the properties of gossip and the problems with gossip. Okay, they are not. It's not a protocol to validate the message. Basically, they also offer a convergent consistency. So basically, nodes converge exponentially quickly to a global consistent state. So they offer an eventual consistency. The important thing is that the information is spread exponentially. So it's really, really fast. They also offer an extremely decentralized form of information discovery, and the good about this is the latency is really small. So unless you want to consume the information really, really quick, gossip is more than acceptable for that. And the last thing that I think that is subjective, this is something that depends on the implementation, but normally they're simple to implement. There are not a lot of complexity, but I have to say that there are some caveats with it. If you are implementing gossip protocols for information dissemination, like this, They're really simple. If you are building overlay networks, it starts to be more complicated. But if you compare this with algorithms like with the stronger reliability guarantees, like Paxos, they're really simple always. Okay. So in this case, for example, as I said, it's information dissemination. They're using push and pull. And basically what is happening is that this node is selecting the other node. So select appear randomly, that is going to be Q. Select what information to send, send information, could receive information, and select and send some information back to P. With that information, it select what information to keep for whatever reason, and then processing the data. And that's it. That's the protocol. I actually implemented it in order to test if this was something that it was so easy, and it is. I don't know if it's going to be ready for production anytime soon, and never probably, but it's so easy to implement. So you can. There are a lot of open source projects in order to dig in if you want to read how to do a real proper gossip protocol for production. SERP is really good. Hyperview is also production ready. It's used, for example, in React. So, okay, so I've been talking about all the good things about the gossip protocols, but they are also they have things that we have to keep in mind. First of all, they are not very efficient because that's one of the things that we saw in the simulator. Messages basically can arrive several times to the same node. So much of the consumption of the bandwidth consumption is redundant. There are ways to improve that. For example, one of the things that they do in SERP is that they shuffle the list of nodes at the startup, and from that point on, what they do is round robin. So in that way, you have a better guarantee that you're going to reach all the nodes that you have in your view. They are also slow. If you compare that with multicast, with hardware multicast, they're slow. The thing is that multicast is not available normally, so that's what you think, what you get, gossip protocols. They also impose some latency, because we saw that they are periodic, right? So if a node has new three messages, it's not going to send that information until the next cycle. So you have to add that latency to your normal latency network or whatever. They are also, as they are randomized algorithms, they are really difficult to debug and to reproduce. Sometimes they don't scale well. Basically, one example of this is when the rate at which information is injected into the system exceeds the capacity of the system, they're not going to work really well there. For example, imagine a node that is receiving more messages than the messages that they can send. At some point, it has to decide or discard messages or overflow. Okay? I mean, it's makes total sense. There is no magic there. And the last thing that for me is really, really important if you want to read papers about them or you want to implement papers is that most of them, not all of them, but most of the papers, they rely on a non-scalable membership protocol. And I'm going to try to explain this a little bit deeper. So what I mean by a non-scalable membership protocol is the thing that you see selected there. So basically, the function, method, service that provide each node with the nodes to exchange information with, we call it the peer sampling service. Okay, it could be basically the random in your language. Okay, the random function in your language. That is basically the function that you're going to provide with the nodes. Okay, that's what I meant by the non-scalable membership protocol. And I'm going to explain this better. So we've seen so far that random selection is key for gossip protocols, right? What's happened is that most of the gossip protocols of the papers assume that this selection of peers follows a uniform random sample of all the nodes in the system. Okay? And with this assumption, what happens is that assumption makes possible to establish many of the desirable features of gossip protocols like scalability, reliability, and efficiency. So, in other words, if random selection is not fair, or the view that each node has it doesn't follow a uniform random sample of all the nodes, all these properties go away, okay? Also, most of the implementators of gossip protocols choose the solution in which each node has a whole view of the system, like I did with my simulator, okay? So basically, every node has a list of all the nodes in the system. So whereas the application and the underlying basic of protocol, for example, imagine that an application is using a gossip protocol for information dissemination, whereas that is supposed to be scalable, it's wrong to assume that the peer sampling service, the service that is giving you the nodes, is going to scale. That's the key problem. Let me put you an example. Let's imagine that we're reading a paper, okay? Here all together. The paper is about how to build an overlay network for geographical proximity. Most likely that paper is going to be focused on how to build the overlay And they're going to assume that each node has a perfect understanding of the system, a perfect view of the nodes in the system, and the selection is going to be fair. And that's what is wrong. It's because that's a tricky problem. So assume that is wrong because of that, because you need something to implement that. So basically what we need is a way to guarantee that the view of the nodes that we have, that each node have, follows a uniform random sample, and the selection of random selection is fair. How can we do that? With gossip. So you can think of this like a meta-gossip protocol. A gossip protocol that uses another gossip protocol for the view. So let's imagine that we have a gossip protocol that is doing information dissemination. Now each node is going to start selecting nodes. In order to select the nodes, it's going to be using the peer sampling service. And the peer sampling service is a gossip protocol that creates the view of the nodes. I'm going to explain it with this because this is something really tricky to explain. So this is a peer-to-peer system. And they're building those two layers, overlay layer and search layer. And in order to build those layers, they're using a lot of gossip-based services, okay? One for topology construction, another for dissemination, for monitoring, and all of them relying on another gossip protocol. That is basically a gossip-based protocol. What is this protocol is doing is basically building a, communicating with all the other node and saying, are you alive? And if they're alive, they're building the list of the nodes, okay? So every time I talk about gossip protocols, so I give this talk or something like that, I receive the same typical questions. They are always recurrent, so that's why I try to solve this in this slide. The first of them, coming from the peer sampling service, is each node has to have a full view or a partial view. So for example, my simulator has a full view. Each node has a full view of the system, okay? But there is another way, that is you can have only a percent of the nodes in your view. So what do you choose? It depends. There are examples of both of them. As I mentioned before, SERP is a good example of a gossip protocol, an implementation that uses a full view, and it's been deployed in cluster up to 10,000 nodes. Hyperview is another example of partial view, and it's been used in React. From my perspective, I haven't implemented both of them, but from my perspective, the problem, they have cons and pros. With a full view, it's easy to implement, but the problem that you have is that it's more difficult to scale, because as your nodes grow, the number of nodes grow, the memory that you need in every node is going to grow too, okay? And with a partial view, it's the other way around. They're easier to scale, because basically, if you only have 10 nodes, it doesn't matter how many nodes you have in the system, the memory is going to be stable all the time, but, it's going to be more difficult to implement, okay? Because basically you have to guarantee that the small view that you have follows a uniform random sample of all the nodes in the system. And in my opinion, that's really tricky to do. Then next one is when nodes stop sharing the information, they keep sending information all the time. That it depends on the algorithm and the implementation. There are some of them that use feedback. So basically, if a node shares the information with another 10 nodes and those nodes already have that information, they stop sending information. There are others that they send the information a fixed number of times, for example, 10. There are others that what they do is they estimate the propagation of messages and they stop sending the most propagated messages. So there are a lot of different ways to do that. The next one is gossip versus Rasov and Paxos. What is an alternative? They are the same thing. So they solve different things. Paxos, RAF, ZAP, they are highly considered consensus algorithms. They require a quorum, so basically more than half of the node have to agree in a value for a value to be true, okay? In terms of the CAP, they are CP algorithms, so basically they trade consistency over availability. And gossip is the other way around. Is AP, so basically availability instead of consistency. So it's pretty normal it could happen that you in gossip ask a node for a data and that data is stale. The next one is gossip affected by partitions? Yes, they are. So if you have a partition and half of your nodes are in this partition and half of the nodes are in this partition, they're going to be gossiping about really happily, like the others are dead. There are solutions for that. That basically, when the network partition is over, they can reconcile. You can see how I'm running out of time, so I can explain that. But if you can understand how they do it, you can serve is a good example of how to do that. And the last one is that they support Byzantine failures. They typically don't. And 1 month ago, I would say, no, no way. But I found out that there is a paper that they try to do something that, for me, is tricky. They basically try to do something like consensus. In order for a message to be true, they wait for receive the message for different nodes. And then that message is considered to be true. But in my opinion, doing that, they're going to be affecting the properties of gossip protocols. But the paper is there if you want to read it. So I run another time. So just one thing. And is that I'm going to, in my slide, if you want to know any of the things that I've been talking about, all these are the references and are there with the links. So that's pretty much it. Thank you very much.